Leanne Stevens, I'm the mayor of Woodbury. Welcome to Woodbury City Hall. I guess next time we do a town hall meeting with our elected officials, maybe Central Park or something, and hoping we're not in violation of some fire code. Again, welcome. I'm not on the panel. You know, locally, most of you know, you've got my cell phone, my email, but I'm willing to stay after if you have local questions. We're excited today to have a panel of very distinguished guests that have taken their time to come and listen to your concerns, answer your questions, or take your comments. Before I begin with the introductions, I would just like to acknowledge that Lisa Wyke, Washington County Commissioner, is also in the office. So first we'll start with Congressman McCollum. One, thank you to her office for organizing this and for her to come out, and she's not feeling well. So for her to be here, we really thank you for coming.
Well, thank you. And Mayor, it's, I think we probably are a little in violation, but you're here. So this is good. This is really exciting. We try to do a lot of town hall meetings. I don't do the tele-town halls, and I know that some of you with the previous representative did that. The reason why I don't do them is, One, you lose the community of getting together and how we come together to solve problems and work on things. And we all work for you. It doesn't make any difference what stripe color we have, you know, what team we're, you know, associated with. We all work for you. So we have a responsibility to work together, to get to know each other better, and to give you what you expect, and that is people who come together to find ways to solve common problems, to find the common ground to move our communities and our families and our country forward. So I want to thank all of you for being here. Now, having said that, I do have a cold, and I thought based on previous town hall meetings, I brought enough cough drops to share. But I'm keeping them. And I know I don't have enough Kleenex. So I do have another engagement that I'm going to try to make it over to shortly. But let me just, so I want to make sure I hit a few things, and I can't even put my contacts in, that's how runny my eyes are even today, so you like my Walgreens specials here. You know, Woodbury is a community that's very near and dear to my heart. My great aunt, who's 104, just lives a couple of miles, not miles, a quarter of a mile from here. And she loves living in Woodbury. And she, being 104, really remembers when it was a small sleeping farming community. But Woodbury has changed over the years. And I know a lot of the changes bring great opportunity, but sometimes they bring great challenges to them. So this is a wonderful place to be, and one of the opportunities and challenges, transit and transportation. And so I've, with representing Ramsey County in its entirety, for the entire time I've been in Congress, Gateway, a corridor as part of the connection between Washington and Ramsey County is something our office has been very, very engaged in, and I know some of you might have some questions on it, but I just, if we don't figure out a way in which to build up our infrastructure, we won't keep the 3Ms, we won't be attracting the kind of new wave manufacturing and high-tech jobs that are really going to be what we need for our children to have the same hope and opportunity that our parents gave us growing up in our communities. And every business I meet with, transit, transportation, getting people to and from work, as well as getting their products to and from manufacturing to market is really, really key and critical. So you've been working on this as a community, and now formally having more of almost, I think I've got the best part of Washington County. It's Stillwater to Afton. It's the most beautiful anyway. So I look forward to any questions that you might have on there. You might have heard of the sequester. You know, let's think about this for a second. We passed a law in Congress, I didn't vote for it, in the hope that, as foolish as it sounded, we'd never implement it, that it would force us to do our job. And I learned a long time ago, you know, you don't vote for foolish laws in the hope that they don't become law. And here's how the sequester, I was at a high school class yesterday, and they said, explain the sequester to me. And I said, if your family really had to make some tough decisions in spending, and you were sitting around the kitchen table, would you say, well, let's cut everything by 8%. Let's cut our mortgage payments by 8%. Let's cut our food by 8%. Let's cut our movie budget by 8%, our transportation by 8%, our health insurance. We're just going to cut it all 8%, and that's how we're going to balance everything. Now, not one of you would do that in your real life. Unfortunately, that's what the sequester is at a basic. There are some carve-outs. The Department of Defense is in one pot of money with VA and state, and then the other discretionary spending is another. But, you know, the military came and testified. I'm on the military subcommittee, and they said, you know, we don't need to be cutting our military teachers by 8% because if the schools aren't open...
Madam, tell us the truth. It's not 8%. It's what? 2.4?
Sir?
It's 2% of the growth.
Wait a minute.
Don't tell us it's
growth.
Sir?
I have a limited voice. People came to hear. I'm going to make comments. And then we're going to open up the question.
We don't want to hear lies.
Sir?
We don't want to hear lies.
Sir? I am going to respectfully.
I will not shut up.
Wait a minute. You have a choice here. You have a choice.
We'll start with the truth.
You can
start
have a choice.
With the truth. Start with the truth.
Look, we need to go. I've got it. All of us stand up here together. All of us.
We're going to have some basic rules.
We came here together, and I know you're not going to agree with me on everything. You're not going to agree with all of us on a lot of things. You might not agree with us on anything. But there are other people who came. And I will not allow, and I will not be party to being disrespected, because then you disrespect everybody else who came.
Oh, give me a break.
You're right. Yeah.
You need the truth. You need the truth.
Speak the truth.
Here's what's going to happen.
Speak the truth.
Here's what's going to happen, folks. It's called self-policing. And I was just about ready to wrap up so we could get to questions that you have.
Yeah.
We can either have a respectful discussion in this room where no one is interrupted. You're not interrupted. You're not interrupted. None of us are interrupted, including you, Sue, when you're talking. I wouldn't dream of interrupting you when you were talking. Or we will end this town hall now. So are we going to be respectful to one another?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Thank you.
Can I just make a comment?
Yes. No, because then I have to let everybody make a comment. I'm sorry.
Let me just set some ground rules since I'm not participating in the panel. And we'll do it like we do our city council meetings. We'll let each of the representatives up here take 2 minutes to introduce themselves and say a few words. And after they've each had an opportunity to do that, we will open it up to the floor. And I will allow anybody that wants to speak,
Yes. Raise
your hand, come up. I'll ask you to do is give your name and your city, and then you can make your comment or ask your question. We will be respectful of each other. If we don't agree with the person, we will not heckle, we will not clap,
absolutely,
we will not wave signs. Because look how crowded this is. We only have 2 hours and we want to get through this. So. We will let the Congresswoman finish her remarks, and then I will introduce each of the others, and they will get an opportunity to give their 2 minutes of remarks, and then we'll go ahead and take comments and questions from the audience.
I just have one thing to say. Betty, are you going to be here for the whole thing so you can actually be here for the questions and comments?
We'll make sure everybody is here for questions and comments.
I do have another
point. You know what we'll do then? We'll let the Congresswoman do her introduction.
Come up there to ask their questions, because that's going to take a lot of time.
Yeah. That's a good point. I'll just let you raise your hand and do that. I'll go ahead and introduce them and let each of them give their 2 minutes summary, and then we'll let the questions for the Congresswoman go first so that she can get out for her appointment.
So, I was getting ready to wrap up because, you know, there's going to be a lot. I want to hear from you, and so does everyone else. Is we need to stop you know, kicking the can down the road. We need to be making the tough decisions, and then in the election, and then in the election process, we stand before you, and you'll either say you did the job or you didn't do the job, and that's what elections are all about. I want to thank you all for coming.
Newly elected state senator Susan Kent, and her district is Woodbury.
Thank you, and thank you everybody for coming out on this wet and slippery morning. And I appreciate the mayor and congresswoman's points. You know, we all want to hear what people say and think. That's the purpose of these venues. So I really appreciate everybody being here and let's having this dialogue. My name is Susan Kent, and I am the state senator for District 53, which includes all of Woodbury plus the southern parts of Maplewood and Oakdale and Landfall. Real quickly, just to tell you my committees and sort of what I'm focusing on these days, I'm working on all three education committees. That includes the E-12 Finance Committee, the Education Policy Committee, which is also E-12, and E being early childhood, so it's early childhood through 12th grade. And I also get to work on higher education and workforce development, and I love that all of those are together under one umbrella. Because what it recognizes is that our kids need a good solid start early in life in learning. That sets them up for success when they get to grade school. They need to graduate from high school, college, and career ready. Then they go on to their post-secondary, whatever fits their dreams and their skills. And then we have a workforce that is what Minnesota has had for so many decades, something that sets us apart and brings and retains businesses here. So that's why I'm excited to be working on that and a number of initiatives within that. The other thing that I'm working on, I'm the vice chair of the Transportation and Public Safety Committee. Lots of discussions, and I agree with what Betty said. You know, we hear over and over and over again from the Minnesota Chamber, from local chambers, from the Itasca Project, which is deeply comes out of the private sector, that we are underinvesting in our transportation system, and it is going to cost us our competitive advantage moving forward, and it's time to fix that now. And I'm really excited to be working on all of that. And with that, I will sit down and let these other wonderful representatives have their turn. Thank you for being here.
And next, I'll introduce someone that I've been working with because it's reelected. So Andrea Key, Representative Andrea Kieffer, who represents a portion of Woodbury. Andrea.
Right. I'm honored that so many of you have showed up today. The reason we're having it with Congresswoman McCollum, and thank you very much for coming today. We appreciate it. This is a new territory for you with redistricting. And I usually hold these town halls every month. It's usually at the library. I call them library listening sessions. I advertise them on my website. I encourage people to come. I never have had this good. I think that this is an opportunity. The reason we're doing this, the reason we invited you, Congresswoman.
Well, I hold my own town halls.
Yes. Well, and you know, we'll learn about those too, but a lot of folks were like, we just want the opportunity to meet you and talk with you and learn how to get in touch with you. Mary and me and Lisa Blake and Susan, you all know us. You know where to find us. We all live in Woodbury, and we're easy to get a hold of. Not that we're saying the Congresswoman isn't, but she is our voice in Washington, D.C. So that's very important. So we're very honored to have you here today. I know that there's a lot of different opinions in this room. I'm going to ask that we keep any local issues that don't have to do with the federal level towards the end of the meeting today, school board types of issues, okay? Maybe wait till after 11:30 for that. I'm wondering, I'm just going to ask a show of hands, because I know there's some real divisive issues, and I sit on Public Safety Committee. How many are here because of gun control concerns? Okay.
That's about right.
Just wanted to have an idea of that. How many are here with concerns of business taxes at the state level? Okay. How about the sequestration? Such an awesome topic. Okay. So we'll make sure that we have kind of maybe a 10 to 20 minutes discussion, meaningful dialogue on these issues, okay? And like I said, with local things, we can wait towards the end. I'm willing to stay later than noon. I'm sure our local representatives, and we have to respect the Congresswoman's time.
I think that's all I'm going to say. Oh, we'll take questions in just 1 minute, sir. And I'll try to make sure we get balanced questions from both sides. And like I said, I'm going to try to time this too. I want to let you know that I'm also, because I asked Senator Kent to say which committee she's on, I also work on a minimum wage working group with Representative Ward, who we'll introduce in a minute here. I also work on the Jobs and Economic Development Committee, the Regulated Industries and Labor Committee. So I'm very, very involved in some of these issues that you'll be hearing about in the news, such as minimum wage, how this is going to affect local businesses in our state. So with that, I'd like to introduce our last but not least guest, Representative Joann Ward, represents the other half of Woodbury and some of Oakdale Maplewood. Thank you. Thank you.
I too am delighted to have so many people here. I see a lot of heads back outside the door. If you cannot hear, can we move forward just a little bit? You know, I don't want to crowd the room anymore, but if people are outside and cannot hear, can we do something to help them out? You've already heard I'm on the Living Wage Jobs Committee, which is a very small select committee that is going to be traveling the state over the interim, doing some research, trying to work out some things that we will then share with all of you, but also with the legislature to make better decisions and perhaps inform some of the things that Senator Kent is working with on the living wage jobs or the education and jobs issues. I'm also on the Health and Human Services Committee and both of the environmental committees. That may sound like, because it is, we kind of cover the spectrum between the among the three of us. We're covering most of the committees in one way or another in the House and the Senate. So you have, you know, if you have a particular interest, there's one of us that can probably more directly serve your answers. Thank you very much for coming.
Okay. Yeah. That's, so I, since this is my district, I got to put pulled this thing together. Again, I want to thank the Congresswoman for coming out to Woodbury this morning. We had to work, the three of us, to try to figure out a date that would work. And so at this point, I'd like to take, let's start, I guess, with gun control. And sir, you had your hand up first, so I'll.
Okay, I'd like.
And would you please state your name,
sure.
Stand up, and tell us which city you live in.
Okay, I live in Woodbury. My name's Leo Wasesha. I'd like to address Representative McCollum. My question has to do with the Department of Homeland Security and their recent purchase of over $1.5 billion cop killer bullets, which is enough bullets to put 5 bullets in the head of every citizen in the United States, and why someone in Congress is not investigating why they are doing that. Whether or not you would be willing to take the necessary steps to begin such an investigation, because to me that's scary, and to me something is definitely wrong that they're doing that. And recently this week, I guess they also purchased something like 3,000 light armored tanks. And something is just terribly wrong with that department.
Okay, thank you.
So could you comment on that?
Well, I will look into it. This is the first I've heard of it.
Oh, there you go.
Okay, guys, let her answer the question, please. Please.
You do now.
Thank you. That's the first I've heard of it. I think, you know, when people bring things up like this in town halls, sometimes they find things out that are pretty remarkably, extraordinary, that are going on in the federal government and deserve oversight, deserve scrutiny. So if you have a site that you can source, we have information on how to contact my office, and we will start looking into it on Monday. If you have a site where I can source, where you have
reports.
All the on there. The what report?
Drudge Report.
The Drudge Report.
If you'll take
the time to send it to my office, we'll take the time to do the investigation. Absolutely will. Thank you.
Thank you. Another question, maybe a little bit different from that, but still related to the gun control. Sir, in the back?
Yes.
State your name, please.
Derek Nelson from Afton.
Thanks.
I have a quick couple questions for our representative in Washington. Do you believe we have a spending problem? That's just a quick question, then I have a follow-up.
I'm
going
to
stay on guns first.
She wanted
to stay on
guns. I'd like to stay
in
touch.
Mix it up a little bit.
Okay.
Mix it up.
I'm fine with that.
Mix it up.
Okay, fine with that. Go ahead.
You said you had a couple of questions.
We have a spending problem.
Would you put them together?
In Washington. And second to that, of course we have a spending problem. We're spending. Okay, so there's my follow-up. Your party says we don't have a spending problem, all right? We have most revenues in the history of America. And we have a budget that's at $3.7 trillion. What are we going to do with our kids when we go to $20 trillion? We go in debt. Our military has already said the biggest, greatest threat to America is our national debt. What are you doing about it?
Well, you know, I never ask a question you don't know the answer to, and you knew the answer. You wanted to your question.
My opinion.
And you know what?
My opinion.
You know what? I agree with you.
Okay.
I agree we do have a spending problem. And I do agree we need to tighten our belts. And we need to make tough decisions, but we also need to make smart decisions. Because as you said, this is about the future of our children. So when we're looking at, we need to get our budget back in balance, but we can't do it at the total expense of, you know, as farmers would say, eating the seed corn. So we know we need to continue to make smart investments in education and infrastructure and that, but we can't do it all. We cannot do it all, and we need to tighten our belt. But we also need to look at what's going on, and they're called tax expenditures. I'm sure some of you are familiar with the Simpson-Bowles report. Okay, so tax expenditures are the new little loophole in which lobbyists go to get their pet projects funded. And when they're funded, they don't even, I'm on the Appropriations Committee, we have public hearings on things.
You had $37 million worth of earmarks last year.
There were no earmarks last year.
Oh, there wasn't. What do you call it now? What's the new word?
There aren't any earmarks.
Okay, well, it's on the website.
So the tax expenditures that are out there are things like, well, we carve out something special for manufacturers of snow globes in a certain district, or we contract something out for wooden arrow manufacturers, or we
or
keep...
Cylindra.
Okay, I'm done talking. My voice will not allow me to be shouted over, so I'll sit down and wait for the next question.
Okay, thank you. Sir, in the blue yes. shirt, okay. Please state your name and
sure.
what city you live in.
My name is Andy Cheroni. I'm here right in Woodbury. My question overall is about gun control, but it's primarily directed at Ms. Kent and Ms. Ward. Obviously, it's a concern. There's a lot of people that are here. I guess I have more of a question slash statement. Number one, my question is, how do you feel about that? Number two, my statement is more of the situation that we're in is win-win. Because if we see, I think the gun laws that we have right now in Minnesota are plenty. Obviously, there's a lot of talk about increasing them, making them more stringent. So it's win-win for us, because if you guys, in particular, I probably know how Andrea would vote. I won't presume to know that, though. If you guys vote for stricter gun laws, well, if you don't, then you didn't vote for stricter gun laws. If you do, there's going to be some fallout. You two primarily, I would imagine, and fallout on Senator Franken, Governor Dayton, and... So what we do is probably, I would imagine, start the new legislative session by reinstating the gun laws and doing so with a full Republican Congress. So I'd be interested to hear your input on how you stand.
Thank you very much for the question. This is an important discussion.
I don't know if everybody heard it.
Did everybody hear the question?
Yeah.
It is a very important discussion, and this is exactly the kind of discussion we need to be having. Again, my primary time and focus in my committees are education and transportation, and because it's transportation and public safety, I need to clarify that in the Senate, judiciary is looking at the issues surrounding gun control, gun safety, all that. Public safety in the Senate committee is the different aspect with state troopers and highway, that kind of thing. So I just wanted to clarify that in terms of the expectations. So I honestly, you know, this is not something I have been following the exact process of the discussion and the bill hearings. I've tried to as best as I can.
I'd recommend you should.
Please don't interrupt. I'm trying to answer your question. Thank you.
My apologies.
I'm trying the best I can, as I say. my understanding of where things stand right now, and I think this is pretty consistent with my views on this. There's a recognition that at the state level, it's really challenging to try to make specific types of bans and do it effectively. And a gentleman standing a couple people to your left, and I've had some great conversations on this issue as well. I've been listening to citizens and their input a lot. I think it's not something that we can do at the state level very effectively. I think there are some questions within the frameworks of our existing legislation surrounding background checks, for example, making sure that people who are convicted criminals don't have access, and when I say convicted criminals, people who have been convicted and done their time and have been released don't have access to guns. And I think those are the areas in which we're making, because I got an email from somebody saying, how come the convicted criminals can get guns in jail? Why are we giving them guns in jail? It's like, no, it's not the people who are in the jails right now. It's the people who have gotten out that we need to make sure they don't have access to. So it's those kinds of areas that I think we can potentially tighten up. I've had great conversations with members of law enforcement who agree with some of that. And that's the area in which I think we need to maintain most of our focus. Thank you.
Andrea and Joann?
I'm going to say, can you explain your no vote on Senate File 339?
I will gladly explain that. Yes, thank you for bringing that up. That had to do with, again, the process and the way that we examine these issues. Because when that was brought up, that motion on the Senate floor.
I'm going to explain what it was.
Okay, yes, thank you. It was a motion from the Senate floor to bypass the committee process and have a vote on the Senate floor in that moment. Please let me finish. Thank you. What that does is it means there's no opportunity for public input on that question. It's important that the way our state legislature works is we have committee processes. And it was so funny, I got an email from somebody that night while there were hearings going on in the ground floor. Michael, where are you? Michael Gerster was here a little while ago. I don't know if he's still here.
He left.
Oh, okay. And I watched him on TV. I was up doing emails in my office, and I was watching the hearing on my television in my office, and I went down to talk to him because he did something courageous for a woman who was there testifying against gun control. Because that's where that discussion needs to happen. That's how people have input, and that's how the elected representatives get to hear it, is by having that public input. And the process that was being proposed to put this as a straight vote on the Senate floor shut out you and shut out your voices. And so that's why I voted that way, because I wanted to be able to have this conversation the way it needs to be at. Thank you.
Can I
follow up question?
We'll have some follow up questions in just a moment. I'll make a very quick statement.
I mean, just on what she just said.
Thank you.
A point of clarification.
You know what? I'm going to just switch this for just a second. I have a background in education, as do most of the people up here in one way or another. And I worked for many years in processes of restorative justice. I have had kindergartners who would know how to listen, second graders, seventh graders, 12th graders, who know how to listen respectfully. That means no rolling eyes. That means no rolling eyes, no comments.
Move on with your
you comments. Listen. There's a difference. If you're listening, then you will hear differently than if you're trying to talk at the same time and if you're being disrespectful.
Okay.
So we need to be respectful for each other, and I will let you talk. Excuse me, sir. That is totally.
We don't need to be lectured, Joann.
Okay.
We have to have it respectful.
Well, it's got to go both ways, though. She's not being respectful for us.
I beg your pardon. We will. I will answer the question. Your question.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. How do I stand on gun control?
Please, we'd love to know.
I'm much more interested in the regulation that the NRA is interested in. There have been surveys by mayors and other people across the country who found that somewhere between 84 and 93% of NRA members want background checks. They want background checks. Beyond that, thank you.
Federal or state?
Mayors.
Doesn't matter, as long as we have the thorough background checks.
It does matter.
That is not part of the survey. The general answer is that we want background checks. Who manages that and how? We'll have to work out it. I'm not on the public safety committees. I'm not on any of the committees that is addressing this.
Okay.
But I want you to know that there is great sentiment to have that much control and to put some more energy into mental health issues.
I appreciate
Andrea,
you guys clarifying your stance. Thank you.
Okay. And there was just one follow-up for Senator Kent, I think, over here. I think we'll move.
Okay, very quickly. A point of clarification, this woman wasn't able to articulate or say what she wanted to say, but it was a strict vote, was it not, on do you support the Second Amendment of the United States Constitution?
Yes. Specifically, do you swear to not violate the Second Amendment?
Okay, yeah, so,
no,
so it, was it just
and
a,
conflict
a,
with
was a simple no, question?
No, it was. That was not the body of what was being, that was not,
but that
the,
was a big part of it.
That was not the full text of it. If
but
you read the entire thing, it was more complex than that.
And
thank you.
Okay.
It was more complex than that. It was not just one single sentence.
That's all I wanted to clarify that. Yeah.
Let's go. If you interrupters keep interrupting, we'll be here till 7 p.m. tonight.
I got the time. I got the time.
Not all of us.
Okay.
I guess, you know, I was on the Public Safety Committee. I did hear the 12 hours of testimony. The bills themselves, if you read them, there's some issues with unconstitutionality. There's some confiscation without compensation. There's a lot of concerns. I support our Second Amendment for a very important reason. It's part of the reason we're a great country. I lived in Eastern Europe. I saw what happened in the 1930s when the government started taking away guns from people. It's really scary. I don't want to see that happen. I will support our Second Amendment. I am a co-author on a House File 1325. I think that's the number. Doug Hillstrom is the author. You can look it up online. Email me. 1323.
Yep.
That was a good interruption. Thank you. Anyway, you know, you can find it. Deb Hillstrom is the main author. If you are concerned with this, I would suggest everyone who feels strongly about this issue to contact Chair Paymar, contact Speaker Susan, and ask that this bill get a hearing, because this would be a good one. I'd like to maybe focus a little bit more on some other issues. Can we give maybe, are there burning issues on guns right now? Okay, you've had your hand up for a while. Go ahead, and then we'll get maybe five more minutes.
So that's kind of a follow-up to what you just said, because I'm supporting your bill, 1323.
Okay.
So I would like to help persuade McCollum and the other ones that are on the fence of supporting it. So I have a question and comments. Well, try to help you persuade to support this. One, have any of you ever purchased a gun? So have you ever even tried to go through purchasing a gun with a background check? Because Minnesota does have some of the hardest background checks. That's why when you get a conceal and carry permit, Wisconsin residents cannot carry in Minnesota because their laws are not as strong as Minnesota laws. Our background checks are strong. And you can't just go to a store and say, I want to buy this gun and walk out with it. They are strong laws. So some of these political people that are trying to write these laws have no clue what they're talking about because they've never even picked up a gun or they've never tried to purchase a gun. So that's kind of frustrating for us gun owners. You don't know what you're talking about. So I'd like to know if you've even tried to purchase a gun to know how a background check works. That's part one of my question. And then of the ones that don't pass the background checks, how many of those are ever followed up upon? Like if they don't pass that background check, what do they do with them? How can we uphold those laws and, you know, crack down on that instead of working on gun control? I think that's where we have to focus instead of putting more of these laws that, well, the criminals really don't care about. So you can arrest them and add 10 more crimes that they're going to commit, when all of us that legally own guns, you're just going to fault us and take them away from us.
Okay.
from a federal level?
Well, first off, I don't have a vote on the bill that you were talking about, but I did hear about it yesterday on the news, and I was very intrigued about it. What was intriguing about it is it looked like people were coming together to find common ground and find a common solution to reduce gun violence. This shouldn't be about gun control. It should be about reducing gun violence in our country. I'll be honest with you. I have no desire to own a gun or have a gun. I'm not between being in two places. I'm not going to start carrying one on an airplane and stuff like that. I don't see the need for it. I call 911. Having said that, though, I've grown up around guns. My grandfather in Montana, a staunch Republican, member of the NRA, had him in the back of the pickup truck. We had one in the glove compartment of the pickup truck because you don't want a crowbar or deer. You want to shoot the deer if you hit it. And so, sometimes people on both sides get just so to the extreme and the passions run so high we stop listening to each other. So I just want to make a comment on the background checks. We have to get this right. We have to get it right on criminal background checks. We have to get it right on what we talk about mental health. Mental health is a big encompassing description, isn't it? And there's patient rights that have to be respected. But we need to allow doctors to be having conversations with patients about, and we need to allow the CDC to do some research on how to reduce gun violence. And that's one of the big areas I'm focusing on. The background checks is interesting because I just had a conversation with law enforcement recently. And you can go through and you can pass the state background check and then show up, someplace and then fail the federal background check. Now, what's that all about? Or you can do the federal background check and then show up and then you can't do the state background check. Folks, we need to get this straightened out. We need to get it right. And if it's not right, there needs to be adjudication process in place. Background checks is something where I think we can come together and find the common ground, but then we have to do it right so people have confidence in the system that they're not arbitrarily being turned away and that we're doing what we can do as a society to prevent gun violence.
I'd like to answer this woman's question since she directed it at me as well. And I'm going to try to be brief because I know there are a lot of issues that people have on their minds that we want to talk about. Real quickly, I'm the mom of a 12-year-old. I can't get to a movie, so there's not a lot of things going on. I don't have a lot of hobbies that involve shooting or anything else, So that's not something I've done recently. My husband does, on very rare occasion, do a little hunting, so, that's sort of his world, but personally, that's kind of where we stand as a family. The issues on the background, I really agree a lot with what Betty said. I think that this 1323, was that the number?
House file.
House file, yes. What I've heard about that one, I think it is intriguing because I think it does sound like real coming together, addressing some of the problems that were identified in the earliest legislation that came out, and trying to come up with some meaningful solutions. So I agree completely with what Andrea said. I hope that Representative Paymer will give that a hearing in the House. So I support pursuing that. And with that, I just think, yes, we do have stringent background checks here, but from what I understand in my conversations with law enforcement, there are areas where, yes, you may undergo a stringent background check in that particular venue when you're purchasing a gun, but not everybody goes through those channels, and because of that, other people are not subject to that same sort of scrutiny. So it's about being consistent so that we can keep everybody as safe as possible without violating Second Amendment rights. Thank you.
You had your hand up. Yeah. Do you have a follow-up to this particular?
No, it's a slightly different question. I'd love everyone to answer if they could, and it's good to see you, Congresswoman.
Thanks to see you again, too.
Thanks to see you.
Okay.
And I know that NDAA was passed not too long ago. That's a federal issue, and Congresswoman McCollum did not vote for that, and I appreciate that.
What is that?
The National Defense Authorization Act. And one piece of that is the ability of the government to take people against their will and detain them without a trial. That's now law. It's been passed.
I didn't vote.
So for what's that?
As you said, I didn't vote for it.
Right. She did not. She did not vote for it. Senator Franken didn't vote for it, but Senator Klobuchar did. To get out of the question. So now the government has the ability to come and take people away and say they have an opinion that Homeland Security doesn't like their patriot or constitutional crazies and they need to be put away. Again, just a hypothetical. Again, sometimes dumb laws get passed that at the time don't really seem to make sense, but years down the road suddenly get used a different way. So the government comes to get me. How do I defend myself, or do I just go with them? How would each of you do that? Would you just go with them, be detained forever? Or would you defend yourself? And if you did defend yourself, what would you be allowed to have in order to defend yourself?
Sticks, gun, fire.
And if each of you could just answer that, would you just go with the government, or would you defend yourself? And again, I realize it's somewhat hypothetical, but 10 years from now, what would you do?
I don't think any of us go quietly into a good night. All right. We wouldn't do what we do.
So when they show up with the armored vehicle and the hollow point bullets and the AR-15s that they bought, what are you going to do?
It's a
fair question. What would you do? Go with
them? Does anyone want to answer this?
Because you're not going to get a trial.
I don't. I appreciate what you're doing and what you're pointing out. As you said, it's right. Not a law. I didn't vote for. Is that we need to have checks and balances on how large our government gets, right. How much control our police and our military have in our daily lives. And as I said, I think we're a group of women that wouldn't go quietly into any good night. So, and there's other questions up. Thank you.
But no, I think it's give everyone a chance to see how they would respond to this, because it's real.
I agree. Like I said, I lived in Eastern Europe. And one of my questions when I went through history tours there, I said, why didn't people fight? Why did they go? It was too late. By the time that came, their property and their personal protection were taken away.
So you're going to barricade yourself and shoot your way out of the government.
You know what? We're going to prevent that from happening in our country.
Thank you.
Let's go on to a different topic, and if gun people want to stay later, I'll hang out later. We're going to move on to maybe... what's happening at the federal? Does anyone have federal level budget questions? You have budget questions, federal level?
Well, this does go along with the budget, yes.
Okay.
And this is for Representative McCollum.
Congressman,
yes.
No, the title's Representative.
It
works cool.
Okay.
And Ken.
Please name your city and your name.
Ken Drevnik, Woodbury. Thank you. This happened yesterday. Okay. The federal government has now taken away reimbursement for college tuition for our soldiers, our Army personnel. This has already followed suit after they've tucked it away from the Marines. Now the Army, there is no more college tuition in certain programs for our veterans. Where do you stand on this? This is terrible. These are our people who defended our right to be here, your right to stand up in front of us, and now they're losing a portion of their college tuition. And it seems to be right back onto the sequester. There's no more money, so we're going to take it away from the military again.
Well, first off, I was going to say that must be part of the crazy, silly across the board cuts, and that's why you don't do things that way, so that you can prioritize and you can honor and keep your commitments. I'm the daughter of a disabled veteran, and I had a family member who served honorably in Vietnam, who had a hard time coming home. And some of you guys in this room know what I mean. And I just lost him last weekend. So this is very dear to my heart. And I watched veterans' benefits in the 80s get stripped away and watered down, especially education veterans' benefits. And that's just goes to another reason why I didn't vote for the sequester. We have to do things where we honor our commitments, especially to the people we asked to put and volunteer. It's an all-volunteer army now.
We need people to voice this and get it back. We're there.
But if you have someone in particular who's in the middle and their tuition's being disrupted, have them call my office. I have a person pretty much that I just dedicate to work on veterans affairs. That's how passionate I feel about it. And did you serve, sir?
No, I did not.
For all of you who served, thank you. And for those of you who are children of the military, you carry a little bit of the burden of your parents with you as they come home. So we need to honor our military.
Thank you.
Michelle, did you have a question? Same topic.
I'm Michelle Ventura from Woodbury. And I am curious, you have an issue with the sequester. and across the board cuts, how do you propose we fund Obamacare? Because it's already ballooning way past what the CBO said it was going to cost. And not only is it an intrusion into every aspect of our life, including control of our lives, because under the umbrella of Obamacare, you can pretty much dictate anything. So you say that you're concerned about the finances of our federal government, you're concerned about the growth of our federal government, but under the balloon of Obamacare, our federal government will become increasingly intrusive in our lives and unaffordable for our children. Is the design to collapse the private insurance system? Because that's what it's going to do.
Yes, it is.
Of course it was.
Well, I thank you for sharing your opinion, because a lot of what you shared was your opinion. And I did vote for the Affordable Care Act, Obamacare. And I voted for it because...
Because the Democratic Party told you to.
Honey, ain't nobody tell me how to vote.
I voted for it because I have witnessed, both as a state representative, as a resident, as a mother, as a neighbor, as a member of Congress, so many families that had a child that had a pre-existing condition that when they graduated from high school couldn't get health insurance.
So why didn't you tackle that issue singly instead of lumping it all in?
You know, I said this once before. I'm not going to shout over people. I'm not going to, shout over. Do you want me to answer your question or not?
Sure.
Or do you want to, if you want me to answer your question, I did not interrupt you.
I would love for you to explain it.
We had people who would be in the middle of cancer treatment and find out that they had ridden an artificial insurance cap. And the list goes on, and it was causing bankruptcy in families. Now, there were some people who wanted single payer, like we have in the VA, a hybrid of what we have with Medicare. But there were some of us who said, let's work with the private sector and come up with something that's not Canadian, come up with something that's U.S. But we had the insurance companies as part of the discussion, and they said, if we're going to cover all of this, everybody needs to be part of it. Our hospitals, when somebody comes and they don't have health insurance, you pay for it. You pay for it on your insurance premium, and you pay for it on your property taxes. Because if somebody gets hit by a car in the middle of the street and they don't have insurance, we're not going to say tough luck, are we? So a big part of that was try to make sure that everybody had access to insurance, and it was going to be insurance that wouldn't leave people high and dry and bankrupt.
But that insurance, okay, the premium is the penalty. Nobody is going to pay it.
Is there anyone else that hasn't asked a question yet about this topic?
So
Kester, go ahead.
Captain Nackham of LeBarry. I am a veteran. I was an Army nurse during the Vietnam time frame. I've taken care of soldiers. I've been a nurse for the federal government my whole life. So I have sent the soldiers and brought them back from war and took care of them. And I am a federal employee, so the sequester, I got my furlough notice last week, or Thursday. I will be giving up 3 weeks of pay between now and September at least. And I get really frustrated with the Congress, whether it's state or federal. I have to meet certain guidelines. I have to do my job. I have to get along with the people I work with. If I ever said words about my leader that I hear senators and congressmen say about their leaders, whether it's state or local or federal, I would not have a job. And so what is Washington or Minnesota doing to get rid of this horrible place our government's been in the last few years? It's been going on for a long time, and we hear it in this room. We hear it right now on a local level, so I guess either it's gotta work from the bottom up or it's gotta go from the top down. But I'm getting very frustrated even just standing here listening to people that don't listen or don't try to get a wide view. But my question, I guess, is on the federal level, is there any hope with this sequester, because it sounds like it will go on till September, then it will get kicked down the road again, because there's this other cliff that's coming up March 27th, and then we'll go through like I've done every year for the past 3 or 4 years,
We don't know if we're going to be funded. We don't know if we're going to be furloughed. It's just getting very, very frustrating. So does Congress feel that frustration on any level? And what are they doing about it, I guess?
First, let me say something. Whether you're an air traffic controller, whether you're a nurse in our VA system, whether you're a person who's picking up the phone to help a senior with Medicare, someone with Social Security disability who's just had a family member who's had a debilitating stroke, thank you for your work. Because what all you're hearing right now is federal employees this, federal employees that. And thank you for taking care of our soldiers, airmen and Marines. You know, I go back, a lot of people tell me I'm crazy to be hopeful, but I'm hopeful. And the reason why I'm hopeful is we just passed a piece of legislation. It was the Violence Against Women Act. And we had, it was bipartisan. I worked very closely with a dear colleague of mine, a very conservative Republican from Oklahoma, Tom Cole, who chaired the Native American Bipartisan Caucus together. And Tom's not a liberal, folks, but he knows that we're there to get a job done. And there are people on that side of the aisle who want to do that, and people on my side of the aisle who said, you know what, this isn't about, you know, me getting everything I want. So I'm hopeful. I'm hopeful that there are a group of us out there that are working on it, and maybe you folks want to comment. I heard about the purple team at the state of Minnesota. There are a group of us who come to work, and we come to work to get the job done. And, you know, I'm not going to give up on working together across the aisle to do what we're supposed to do. And then I'll stand in front of you when it comes to the ballot box. And if you don't like the job that I've done, you'll vote me out of office. But you expect me at least to go there and do something.
From the state perspective, I want to echo what Betty said. I love the purple caucus idea. One thing that
encourage... Well, wearing purple.
That's right. And I think it's really interesting when you look, and I want to point out that the people who are here, the elected representatives, we're all women, for whatever that's worth. And we all represent different parties, and we all work together on a regular and ongoing basis. And when you, and one of the things that I think, and I'm a newcomer to this, you know, I've been in office, 2 months almost to the day, right? So I'm a Woodbury mom who has gone to do this to fight for some things that I think are important for our state and for our future, right? And so as a newcomer, observing with very, you know, much a bystander's perspective, I sit in those committee meetings every day, and I watch people from both parties agree on an awful lot of issues. There is a lot more agreement than you hear about. And I encourage everybody to pay attention, get involved. You know, the nice thing about particularly state government is you can go to the website for the House or the Senate, you can sign up for the email announcements for any committee, for any issue you're interested in, and you'll find out exactly what bills are being heard when. You can often watch them online. You are welcome. Please come down. Our Capitol is so open. We have so many people, neighbors, friends, people who are interested. Just show up and watch these hearings, and you can see the discussion, and you can see how many times I vote with Mary Kiffmeyer, which actually happens, you know? So it's, I'm with Betty. You know, there is reason to hope, and there is always, you know, the only way we're going to make the changes that we need are if we do continue to have that hope and do continue to work together on some of these issues. So thank you.
There was a question in the back. Was that a follow-up? Way in the back?
Yes, to that. Okay. You mentioned the Purple Caucus. I'm Brian Stolberger from Woodbury. You mentioned the Purple Caucus. I think part of the problem with compromise is just broad strokes. Republicans in general want lower taxes, lower spending. Democrats in general want higher taxes, higher spending. And so you compromise, and what do you get? You get lower taxes and high spending, and our government... our federal government, the U.S. dollar, I mean, that's what a lot of us are concerned about, is our kids, is the dollar is going to fail, and we're going to have hyperinflation, and all of these sorts of things, and nobody's doing anything about it, so we need some Democrats to vote for spending cuts, and maybe we need some Republicans to exchange some tax hikes for spending cuts, but I think that has to be job one, is to get the federal spending under control. Stop funding the Vikings and the Hollywood.
Okay, to this question.
I'm Daryl Rass from Little Canada. I don't mind paying taxes, but I do mind when Washington wastes money. We've had a selective service for 40 years. We spent $1 billion to draft nobody in 40 years. Get rid of it. Only 25% of our high school graduates can pass a military physical right now. Get rid of selective service, save $24 million a year. It doesn't cost anybody anything to get rid of $24 million. Medicare, fraud, waste, abuse. Washington passed a bill a number of years ago that Medicare cannot buy drugs from the manufacturer. That will be a middle person. Get rid of that. It's been estimated that 20% of Medicare is fraud. There are people setting up straw businesses. Mm-hmm. They bill. The government has to pay within 30 days. Change that they don't get paid a penny for 90 days. And they have put up a half a billion dollar loan, a bond, before they get paid. Simple things. Use simple things. I don't mind paying taxes. I'm a veteran. I did Vietnam War. I've done the first Gulf War. The flight nurse. Don't waste my money.
Well, Medicare Part D, which was the prescription drug benefit under President Bush, didn't allow us to do what we do with the VA, which is get the best price by doing bulk purchasing. That was one of the most overriding objections I had to that bill. I'm on legislation in the past Congress. It hasn't been reintroduced yet. We're trying to get hearings to do exactly that, sir, so that we take advantage of the best purchasing price. And to his point about what had been going on in Medicare, because I mentioned President Bush with the Part D that I didn't like. I give President Bush full faith and credit for starting to work really hard to cut down on this huge fraud that's going on in Medicare. And Florida was one of the places where he was focusing on. Some of the gangs found out it was better to get into setting up a P.O. box and stealing seniors' private information out on the internet and then setting up to be these straw vendors for wheelchairs and that. So they've been going after that. There's a lot more work to do, and that's just that's something that started under the Bush administration that the Obama administration has kept moving forward. And I know some of you don't want to hear this and you don't like to hear this, but with the sequester and the way that it's set up, and we don't prioritize that investigation and what we're working on to do the oversight to stop that also got a cut. So we need to do things smarter, to the gentleman's point in the back.
There's a
the selective
service.
Oh, listen, I'm on record.
That's
gotta go. There's a
follow-up. Is this for Congresswoman McCollum? Yes, for
Congresswoman McCollum. Congresswoman
McCollum,
there's a follow-up on your
call. Nate Zinker from Woodbury. I had a couple of questions I wanted to pose to the Congresswoman related to the sequester and the budget overall. Number one, with the sequester, I know we've been talking about where some areas of specific cuts were, but if I recall correctly, the law that was passed did not specify particular programs, particular things that had to be cut. That ultimately was up to the president and the heads of those departments to make those cuts. And as a citizen, I find it offensive that they would go after the things that are the most painful for our citizens, and especially for our veterans, rather than looking for some of the wasteful areas that we have in Washington that could have been cut instead. So that's just kind of a general comment, and perhaps you can correct me if I'm wrong on that the law didn't specify that we'd had to cut college funds for veterans. Secondly, I think we can all agree in here that clearly spending at a federal level is out of control right now. And I wonder if the Congresswoman will be willing to support a constitutional amendment at the federal level that requires a balanced budget every year, much as the requirement we have here in the state of Minnesota, and also would put a cap as a percentage of GDP on the federal government so it can never exceed a certain percentage of the country's gross domestic product. That way we ensure that the size of government doesn't continue to balloon and expand beyond what it needs to do.
Mm-hmm. first on the sequester, and you know, you ask a good thing, and that's and so I'll use the Department of Defense for an example. The president has very little discretion with the sequester. The law says it's across the board. We had the Joint Chiefs of Staff, in front of the Subcommittee on Defense and Appropriations that I was at, and they were like, we're handcuffed. We can't make the smart decisions because of the way the law was written. And so the legislation that just passed the House gave the Department of Defense and the administration some ability to start prioritizing. Well, we should have done that in all the agencies. We have been cutting and lowering the amount of spending to GDP, and I have things on my website that aren't my numbers or whatever, and I don't have them in my book right here with me right now. And I have staff here, make sure when I'll get you a letter back on that with numbers from OMB, not my numbers, not Democratic numbers or whatever on that. But part of the reason why we're so out of balance is we put two wars on a credit card.
You're here.
We put two wars on a credit card. We did not pay for Iraq, and we did not pay for Afghanistan in real time. And guess what? The bills have come due. So that, you know, that is part of the problem, is the history we're living with that accrued and accumulated the debt. To your point on, you know, in Minnesota we have what's called the price of government. And it was something that we had in the Minnesota legislature that I wish we had federally. And it does exactly what you're talking about, is you measure and you stay within parameters, and there's public hearings and everything else on what we're going to do on spending. So I really think that we have big problems if we don't get our deficit and all of it under control. That means that I will be, you know, looking at trimming, cutting, and maybe even at times eliminating things that I think that are very important to our community. But when you put them on a priority list, they're not at the top. And that's not going to make me popular with some of the people in my own party.
May I ask a clarification on something?
Yes.
When you say cutting, I'm aware that the way that the budget works in Washington right now is what's called baseline budgeting, which means that every year the budget is already at, you know, $3.4 trillion or whatever, and it's assumed that the next year it needs to go up 3% or 4% or whatever for inflation. Whatever else.
And
when you're talking about cutting, are you talking about actual cutting of saying, no, instead of $3.4 trillion, we're going to go down to $3.2 trillion?
Great question.
When we hear about cuts in the media right now, what we hear is, well, this year we spent $3.4 trillion, next year we're going to spend $3.5, but instead they're saying we want to only spend $3.45, which is still an increase, but that's a massive cut and we all need to panic because of it.
Let me,
if someone can understand some of the mathematics, I'll find that.
My debate coach, they give you a book when I was in South St. Paul debate, and it's called How to Lie with Statistics. You know, that's why it's so important everybody works off the same set of numbers and everything. Let me give you an example of real time of what I'm living with, and I'm not asking for any crocodile tears here. I can buck it up, I can do it. 11% cut is what my office got last year. My office here took an 11% cut.
Okay.
My territory expanded. The number of people that I have to represent expanded. So I have more people calling in with help, with questions, and, you know, more gas mileage for my staff. And by the way, thank you, Your Honor. I couldn't afford to be in Woodbury once a month without the City Council allowing us to be in this fabulous building with staff here to do outreach. So thank you so much. So, you know, we're finding ways to make things work. Now, I just got another 8% cut. So that's not on inflation. So we are really, really, really cutting in Washington. And that means we're cutting too.
There's a hand in the back that's been up forever. Go ahead.
My time is valuable as a congresswoman. I'd like to hear from the state senators on the, both of them please, on the discussion regarding funding pension funds for state employees, the underfunded pension funds.
What's the question?
Is there, what do you want to know?
I want to know what, whether that you're for state taxes funding underfunded pension funds.
No.
It's a state issue. Could we stay on sequester and federal issues and bring it back?
Can I follow up with real quick. Just to get some perspective, you say the defense budget is being cut. I just wonder how big is it and how much is getting taken away?
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. Well, that's to be determined right now because it's going to a conference committee. So what the sequester did is it took defense, the Department of Veterans Affairs, and the State Department and put it in one tranche.
Okay.
And then it took all the other spending programs and agencies and put them in another tranche. Okay. And said we had to get to this magic number of having $4 million in cuts.
Right.
And so that's kind of what they're working toward. But it's now it's fluid, and so I can't give you a specific answer right now. But we'll keep things updated on our website as things progress forward. Now the Pentagon has said that they're willing to do some cuts, in R&D and some of their states, some of their equipment rollout and that. But where they don't want to cut, and where I don't think we want to see them cut, is in what our servicemen and women need to do right now in Afghanistan and around the world to get the job done, for pilots to get behind on their training and flight hours, and for quality of life issues, which even as General Amos from the Marine Corps goes, what are you guys doing in my schools? Because military schools are funded totally different than other schools are. So in a real time, the military school teachers, as some of them as federal employees, are seeing what this nurse here saw.
Mark Spodka from Woodbury. So we've kind of established that you're all in favor of cuts. One of the big problems I see is the intrusion of government into persons' daily lives with regulation, into businesses' daily activities with increased regulation. It just seems to be continual escalation of regulation. Is there anything specific that you, any of you up there, are working on to stop that escalation of regulation in the government? Would you be willing to make a commitment to say, if I'm going to increase a regulation, I am going to find some other regulation that will have an offsetting balance or even make that balance better for us out here as taxpayers? Thank you.
State questions.
State regulation. I tried to deregulate as much as possible. An example of what's happening that's real scary is there's a real push to unionize home daycares. And I don't agree that we should be doing that. Daycare providers don't want it. The judge shot down the executive order last session when the governor tried to bypass the legislature and do this through executive order, and the judge shot that down. I was on those committees fighting for that, for the daycare providers. I wanted to say to the lady that was talking about division and government, and I hear this all the time, and there's a lot of stuff that does get done well. But just the other day, the governor said he's not going to do the sales tax expansion or the biz-to-biz service taxes. I want to tell you, it's your voices that influence that decision, so I want to thank you. Mm. I'm in a minority. I have really no voice down there. So you are my voice. You're going to boost me up and be stronger. And I think that's where government will work from the grassroots. From a leadership standpoint, my husband and I love the movie Invictus because it's a great story of how a leader of a country brought a divided country together and found some common goals to work towards. I would like to see that from our leadership. I'm talking about at our presidential level and our governor's level. And I try really hard not to bash other people that don't agree with me. I try to be respectful. My bills, you can look on them online. I have Democrat authors. I try to work on good public policy and get out of the fray of trying to make the other guy look bad. So that's what I'm going to say about that. Thank you.
Can I just add to this question as well? I come from a business background, a small business background, so I hear you. It happens that in the case of education and transportation, I don't have as many hands-on opportunities to do exactly what you're asking for, but I agree. I think, particularly when it comes to small business, I think a lot of these things are additionally onerous because you don't have the big departments of lawyers and accountants and all that to work through it. So, I'm always going to fight for the small business to be protected in some of these. I want to echo what Andrea said regarding the governor's budget from the other party side. The governor said from the beginning that that was a beginning discussion, and he put those things out there, and he was open to other ideas, and he was true to his word. And I really appreciate that, he announced that he was not going to pursue the B2B taxes. And a lot of that was because I know Representative Ward spoke to him recently, and we've all had these conversations, and we've all been representing what we're hearing from our communities, that this isn't what's right for Minnesota for our future. So thank you.
Quick comment here. I want to say that Andrea and I have sponsored some bills together, and to your point, just to complement what they're saying, most of my work is in health and human services and in the environment. And there is a real focus in both of those areas to be streamlining things so that it makes sense and we're making good judgments, good decisions. So moving things away, it's more about consolidating in thoughtful and efficient ways, but it's also holding these governmental agencies accountable. So that we have charged them with doing something, we give them some money to do it, and I say, okay, what have you done, and how are you going to make this real in the future? So, thank you.
Was there a question?
I have a federal question. I know Congresswoman McCollum, it's nice to be here, and I know you have time factors, so I want to get this question in. Who am I?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. Excuse me. I'm Bob Kieffer. I'm a Woodbury resident, and I have a question. It's federal, and I just for you, a federal question because and it's kind of on principle too. Do you think we should study things and know what cost benefits are before we throw money into them? I'm not meaning that as a trick question. No, I honestly mean it as a principle because I'm sure that you want to see benefits. I'm not trying to cast any aspersions. Our congresswoman wants to see benefits like we all do. And here's what my concern is. You had a visit recently from some of our esteemed local folks, maybe in the middle of February, from the mayor and the gateway transportation person. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure you had a nice get together and talk about things, but here's what I'm concerned about. That they may have brought you things that I think you need to be careful and looking closely at. One would be, because I heard you talking about infrastructure and meaning so much, that this Isanti project, I don't know if they mentioned it, but I and a colleague went to hear about that, because what they did is they studied the whole metro area and said, we gotta put $20 billion into transit around here if we're gonna be competitive with Denver, et cetera, et cetera. And so I and my colleagues, we said, well, all right, fine, because they had a study saying there were benefits, so let's see the study results. And I went to the, we actually went to the author, the presenter of the study, and asked him and his research associate, give us the data, we'd like to see it. Well, we never got the data, and we got kind of, ambiguous answers. And so that bothers me, because it's a lot of money. And the other thing is with this Gateway project here, which, $400 million, or maybe five, I don't know by the time we get. I asked the people there and the chief planner here in Washington County, won't mention her name because I mentioned it too many times. She said she gets bad feedback every time I mention it, but she told me that the benefits were undetermined. And what does that mean? Do you know what undetermined is? If you go and buy stock, what is undetermined? determined. I mean, you know, so I just think you need to know that these studies for this stuff, and you know another thing? There's a local Woodbury Foundation. They have a study on there. 1% of us Woodburyans would ride a light rail. I know there's a, oh, we're not going to have light rail, but the studies are for both BRT and light rail. They have to be done that way, I guess. And so we could have light rail, because any BRT is built to accommodate light rail. So I, again, I'm not trying to trick you, but please understand, I don't know what they told you, and I love all these folks, but and they have an opinion, but I've talked to them about this. I've been to the city council and told them exactly what I'm telling you. These studies, they're not there, and so please, if we're going to spend federal money, which is our tax dollars, you know, be careful, because I myself and some of my folks disagree with me. I think smart buses are the answer. I like them.
Yeah.
But and they can go on anywhere, and they don't need special lanes or anything. But you know, we've got now hybrid buses. We can have little buses, big buses for whatever we need. Anyhow, I appreciate you listening to me, and please, I'd even like to come to your office and show you some of the facts and figures if possible. So, but thank you.
Congressman, I might just clarify too, Bob. I think it's not ISANTI. Are you referring to the
ITAS? The ITAS project.
One of them. Well, thank you for listening. You were listening when I came to the council. You listened.
And if you could do all 87 counties in order, you'll. You know, one of the things that we do together as a team, because it is a partnership, it's federal, it's state, it's county, it's local, and that is infrastructure, because it's, you know, we all use it, and we have different funding structures that come together to put these projects together. And I'm very pleased that, you know, I think I did what you wanted us to do early on, is I said we need to study this project and see how it moves forward. Now, I know that there are people who you know, think that, you know, we shouldn't have you know, light rail in here. And the numbers might not bear that it makes any sense right now. So we shouldn't do it. I mean, we've got to make top priorities and tough decisions, even though some people really might like to do it. But then the next decision becomes, you know, how many of you have lived in Woodbury longer than 15 years? Has Woodbury changed? So part of our responsibility is to plan wisely for the future, for the next generation, and not be foolish with the investments we make. So that's where you start getting into what kind of buses do you do. If you do BRT with a dedicated lane, two things happen. One, the buses do move faster. Ask the bus drivers, ask, you know, I mean, there's research on that that'll show it. And secondly, it lays a foundation for in the future, if we as a community 15, 30 years later decide that light rail is what works for the next generation, we're not going out and disturbing businesses or homes or paying for expensive right-of-way. We have secured that for the future. And so that is what the task force and the county and the state and the city and the federal government keeps asking for these numbers. What do the numbers look like? What is a wise investment? So I, you know, people here can speak better to exactly where the timelines are now, but I truly believe we have a responsibility not to make a foolish investment, but a wise investment. And that is what our grandparents and our parents have done for us, and our children should expect no less. So yes, we need to do our homework.
Is this related to transportation?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Follow up to transportation, and then you had something back there.
Linda Stanton, I live in Woodbury. I just want to say that my problem with it is that we send our money to Washington, and they send us back this menu. And what I want is not on the menu. We need lanes for cars going in 94 into the city. My job, I can't use the light rail, I can't use the bus. I need my car for my work. We need lanes for our cars. We need that on the menu. The gateway, it's not even on the menu. All it is BRT, LRT. Lanes for cars needs to be on the menu.
Okay, is there any other transportation comments?
Quick.
There's one transportation comment.
I'm going to make a comment.
Fritz Krusch of Woodbury, World War II. Thank you for your service. Woodbury loves you.
Did you have a transportation question?
Steve Allenwood from Woodbury. The Itasca project, Jay Cole stood up in front of us and literally said that if we put a $5 million investment today, within 10 to 15 years, we're going to get a 15 to 30% billion dollars back for that. So my question to him is, my question is to you, why are we subsidizing it?
okay, just to clarify your question, who would pay for it?
If this was something that was needed, the general market would do it on its own.
Right.
And you people keep saying, not you people, but people keep saying, that we needed to get minorities and other people from one point to another. Then why do we have Section 8 housing being spread around except for North Oaks? And by the way, I want Section 8 housing in North Oaks. With a light rail going to it.
I'm going to push back a little on your numbers because you said something about $5 million and a $30 billion return.
$5 billion.
Okay, I just want to clarify that. That the issue is, and this is what we saw when our interstate system was built, there's not an opportunity for individual businesses to do this. 3M, for example, is very supportive of Gateway. You know, there is a lot of private sector support for this. Yes, there is. and the chamber, yes, exactly. The chamber is very supportive. And to your point, Linda, about the question of you're not going to take light rail, I may not take light rail either. Although I might, you know, if it's ever built and I'm still working downtown, but. The fact is, a lot of people would, and they would take those cars off the highway so that then you could drive a little more expeditiously, and that's the point. Because it's all the whole metro area is what we're looking at, and all of these things are planning into the future. I think one of the reasons Woodbury has been so successful, and I've had long conversations with the mayor and city administrator Clint Ridley about this, is we have this wonderful history. When we were 20,000 people, we were planning for when we'd be 40. And when we were 40,000 people, we were planning for when we'd be 60. Now we're 60, we're planning for when we're going to be 80. We can't fix these things overnight. We cannot wait until Lisa White, I think, articulates mm-hmm. some of this really well. We cannot wait until we go, oh my gosh, this is a huge problem. It takes me 15 minutes to get to work when there's no traffic, but when the weather's bad or there's a crash, it takes me an hour. That is an economic cost, not to me personally, but to our employers, for that to be happening thousands of times over. And that is what the Itasca project tries to quantify, is to look at the data analysis.
I just want to respond to one thing here, because you said about taking cars off the road. I talked to Alyssa Leitner, and she told me that there's no relief in congestion from light rail. It just spreads it around. It's where we're going to live.
Was there another question in the back about transportation?
Well, this is a comment about subsidizing things. Another question. It's not related to transportation.
And we need you to speak up.
My name is Ed Davis, and I'm with St. Paul. I live in St. Paul. So a comment about the idea of subsidizing things. If you didn't know, the internet would have never probably happened if it hadn't been for the subsidization of it by the military. So it didn't take off until the military had basically set up most of the infrastructure and tested it and designed systems to allow it for happening. So whether we subsidize things is a question more of, will the private sector do it? And in some cases, the private sector won't do it. Period.
Maybe there's a reason for that.
No, it's not a reason necessarily, because I'd say that our economy has truly grown from the internet. But along the lines of my second thing, cost of benefit and levels of effective regulation. Betty stated, Congressman McCollum stated that Woodbury has agricultural roots, just like the whole state does. And our Constitution, in fact, has a provision in it which is somewhat unique, in that it says that a farmer can peddle their goods directly without having a license. It's the idea of a one-on-one exchange between two people. The levels of regulation necessary, the handshake is enough. But our current laws actually prohibit that kind of relationship from happening. And so as Woodbury people, St. Paul, Minneapolis, the urban people, as we become more and more urban, they're having a much harder time being able to have this relationship with their farmers. And so there's specific regulations that actually stop that from happening. And in particular, I'd want to know how you feel about restrictions on direct purchases and subsequent deliveries by farmers of raw, unprocessed dairy products. Because I feel that there is a strong argument that raw food in general, across the board, is much more helpful than the stuff that you find in the middle of all our grocery stores, and which and which all of the urbanites that I'm speaking now, they are people who live in St. Paul and Minneapolis, are stuck buying.
Thank you. Thank you. I get your point. Actually, I have my raw milk supporters in the room today, Eileen, and I did support that bill, actually. For time, we need to let Congresswoman McCollum leave, but I wanted to just give her...
Not right now.
We'll continue this, but we need to let the Congresswoman
go.
It's
germane to the whole topic. Because of the support of Obamacare, there's an attack on the First Amendment, on the right to religion and to religious practices. And I know that, and I supported the Congresswoman when she was running for the seat that was vacated by Bento. But my point is this, that Obamacare law was passed unilaterally by the Democrats without being read, and I'm sure that the congressman would attest the fact that she didn't read the entire bill. Okay, all right, I'll just speak for Nancy Pelosi then, okay, because she said that. But the point is now that the intricacies of that bill are being revealed, and one of them is an attack on religion, and forcing people against their beliefs to do things. Now, I know that there are many issues that are before the courts, but there are conflicting things before the courts. I wonder, how do you feel about religion? How do you feel about defending the First Amendment of the Constitution?
I, with a group of Catholics, worked to say to the administration early on, current law, that what a church, a mosque, or a synagogue collects in its coffers for its employees, for its direct employees, should be the church's, the church, the current law is right now, what gets collected at the, whether it's a basilica or one of the other Catholic churches around here, and I'll just use the Catholic Church as an example, that money that goes in to operate that church because of their opposition to birth control, that there should be a provision that they can opt out from providing that.
Right.
However, and this is what you're not going to like, probably.
Okay.
We have, if you look at the rich history of the immigrants that came to St. Paul, and I'll just use St. Paul as an example. There's St. Joseph's. There is St. John's. There is Bethesda. Many of these were faith-based institutions. And they have amalgamated into Health East now. And one of the beautiful things about Health East is it still keeps us as its core a holistic approach, including a spirituality approach in healing. Now, what the current law does say is that if a Lutheran nurse works for Health East now, a nonprofit organization, and this is amalgamation of other faiths that came together to form Health East, that woman have an option, that family, that couple have an option on their insurance for birth control. Now, no one's forcing her to take it. No one's telling her she has to take it. But it is available to her and her family should they choose to want it. And so that is something I do support. Okay. Thank you very, 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 very much.
Enough.
And we will be coming back. I have forms in the back. We have an electronic newsletter. I have a large territory to cover. We do periodically do town halls. I like to do town halls where we're together as a group. And I want to thank you all for coming on what could have maybe been kind of a treacherous morning. I don't know what the weather's done, so walk gently when you go out. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We do need to make sure that if you want to continue conversation, you can email the Congresswoman, and I know that she will get back to you. She represents us, and I know she wants to hear from you. And it does make a difference to hear from you. People on both sides of issues with me, I love to hear it, and I get lots and lots and lots of emails on both sides of various issues. We can continue this, and sir, you had your hand up. So.
Yes, I wanted to talk about the corruption in the Department of Labor. Now, I've written letters to a lot of senators and a lot of legislatures. The Labor Department for construction. No, the state. This state.
Okay.
All right. They start all these rules. They never notified us about rules. My two sons and my son-in-law, we had a business, and we were a family business doing electrical work through the state. We did storm damage. It's all we really well did. We get in an argument with the State Farm Insurance, and then it took on a life of its own. I was bidding on some projects in St. Paul on Payne Avenue against, we were taking some state money to redo all the stores along there. One of the inspectors for the city of St. Paul showed up on my job, told the people I was working for if I didn't get rid of this non-union contractor, he wouldn't okay any of the work. I put a complaint in to the city. This guy was allowed to quit his job. Now he's the president of the local 110 electricians union. I get a complaint on against my license on a guy I've never met, never worked for, never been at his house. He came in and then they ripped me apart. I had a 10-day trial in the state of Minnesota. My two sons, my son-in-law had trials. They got fined $2,000 each and banned from working in the state of Minnesota for 2 years. I got a $30,000 fine. And I'm banned from working in the state of Minnesota for 2 years. Even though they gave me 7,000 pages of evidence, disbarred my first attorney, threatened my second attorney, I went in on a pro se, they gave me 2 days to read 7,000 pages and come up with a defense and get my witness list in and all my stuff put in to be admitted. I had a 10-day trial without any evidence and I got convicted. Now, the law that they convicted me on, they never sent out any notices to anybody. My sons never got a notice. I never got a notice, and they admitted that they never sent the notice to me. Tim Barrett, Monami died. Yep, oh, you can look me up on Google. It's a long thing. You know, they put the conviction in, and the judge said, yeah, he was never able to put up a defense, and he was never able to have any rights. There's no rights at all in the Department of Labor. None. They recorded my first conversation when I sat down with the investigator. She said there was no recording. She said it at all three of the kids' trials, there was no recording. On the ninth day of my trial, the other guy in the room, he admitted there was a recording, and they let all her notes in, as evidence what I said. And I didn't say any of that stuff. So when I asked the recording, it went away. So they gave me a trial when the government was shut down. They gave me a trial when the government was shut down, and I got...
Sir, these folks don't represent Montevideo.
We don't represent...
I understand that, but I wrote too many letters. Too many letters, and everybody ignored me.
Okay, I'm just going to...
I thought Betty McCollum was my richest. She was the one that was on my thing. She was here. That's why I came. I'm sorry about that, but I wrote a whole lot of letters that no one paid any attention. And the law they never told us about. So I'm banned from ever doing any work in the state of Minnesota again on a law that I never heard about. Never. Now, I thought sending in unemployment, I got a contractor's license and workman's comp, I thought that was enough, even though I wasn't told what to do or anything else. So I had my first trial in front of Ken Peterson when the government was closed.
All right, take it out. Okay. Time out.
Yeah, wait. Sure. As soon as you mention anything non-union against union, I was non-union, I refused to sign a contract. And look what happened.
Well, I want you to know, first of all, that you have a friend. Because I've been on record in committee challenging the unions even this Thursday. And I can show you the tape. I just stated that I was involved in fighting the child care unionization in the last session. Now they're trying to do it legislatively this session. I'm fighting that. I have supported right to work in our state. I think that your frustration, and trust me, we all feel it in this room. We know what you're.
There's 180 contractors that got put out of business.
Let me just finish. This goes to what you were saying over here. What's going on with regulation? Departments have too much control. The legislature flips and flops who's in control, Democrats, Republicans. Departments have the control.
Right. Mm-hmm.
The commissioners are appointed by the governor. I know that. That's a little bit political. You're going to have to work locally with the people that represent you, but please start to get, I'm not going to micromanage this problem right here in this room. It's not the forum. But if you want me to help you, even though I don't represent you, I can probably find the representatives that do. I work a lot with the Department of Labor and Industry because I'm on the Work Comp Council. I know Commissioner Peterson very well. I know a lot of the people in the department, and I will try to help you if you need to get your voice heard, okay? But this is not the forum. Let's see. We need to hear from a new voice here.
Follow up. Kind of related to all our conversations.
Okay.
My name is Gloria Zeal. I am a licensed family child care provider in Woodbury.
Good.
I have been doing this for 20 years as a licensed provider. I've been in the field for 25 years. And this is about government working smarter, taking statistics and information and really assessing that before we make blanket laws and rules with itty bitty bits of information. There are like three major changes happening in the state of Minnesota right now with daycare licensing that will dramatically impact the availability of child care for the state of Minnesota, which is going to impact the workforce. The first one, the union. Whether you're for the union or not for the union, I believe that people in the United States have a right to form unions if they want to. We have a long history of that. I am opposed to the fact that there's 11,000 licensed providers. Even though I've done this for 25 years, I'm not allowed to vote on whether there's a union, but I have to be a member of it if it is voted in. So there has to be, as an American citizen, as a small business owner who's going through a lot of over-regulation changes right now, I do not feel that that's fair. If we're going to call for a union, we have to have all licensed providers available to vote whether they want to be in the union, not less than 40% of them. So we need to allow for that. That's referring to HF 950 and SF 778. The other changes that are happening have a lot to do with changes in the regulations to providing for the safety and care of children due to the increase in sudden infant death syndrome occurring in child care. This is something quality care providers are concerned about. We do have a voice. We have the Minnesota Licensed Family Child Care Association. They have put a lot of work into a position paper about what kind of changes make sense and are research-based versus a bunch of other paperwork regulations that will not improve the quality of care. If we have providers who need to document every 15 minutes that they're checking on an infant in paperwork and keep all this paperwork while they're taking care of up to 11 other children, that is not going to improve the quality of care. It's going to improve paperwork. If we mandate that they have to use $300 plus monitoring devices for the care of infants, which the American Academy of Pediatrics strongly recommends people do not use. It's not good practice. What we want is people checking on children, not more devices surveillancing children. And then those devices, who knows if they can be tapped into it, et cetera. Anyhow, I really encourage you, because the three representatives that we have here cover
not only it from a labor perspective, but from being on the early child committee and et cetera, along with the changes that are coming with the parent aware, that we make our changes based on actual research. A study that was done a number of years ago by the vice president of our Federal Reserve Bank in the Twin Cities area, which he's updated statistics, it's still there today, shows that as a nation, for every dollar we spend on early childhood, we have a $7 return in investment down the road. You will save more money, you will generate more revenue for the future if we invest in early childhood instead of in things like stadiums and special interests and organizations that should put, as you say, if it's a good business, well, let them pay for it themselves. Thank you.
So I did write an article in Pioneer Press. It's on my website, AndreaKieffer.com, if you want to look at my opinions on this whole child care, but you hit pretty much the same points I said. If they're going to unionize, they all should have a voice in the vote. And then the other problem is we are not a right-to-work state, so you'd be forced to pay even fair share dues, yes, which I consider not a, a freedom issue.
Can I just respond to that too? Thanks. I just want to say I do agree with you. I mean, I think that the issues you've outlined, first of all, we do need to be data-driven, and I think that, you know, some of these, I know there's some concerns within some in the child care community, and they believe that organizing would be the solution to it, but in my research of it, I have a lot of questions about it. So thank you for bringing it up, and I'm hearing you.
And as an example about how we can get this done, my husband had to leave because this room was physically too hot for him. He's in the same union, and he's a union steward, so we have different points of views, but we make our family work under one budget.
There's a new voice. Okay.
Andrea, I'm Mary Jo Larson in Woodbury, and I'm wondering how you feel about the freedom, the Act Freedom to Marry Bill.
The Freedom to Marry Bill?
Yes. How will you vote on that? It's very important to me. I'm for it. And I'm just wondering how you feel about it.
I haven't decided how I'm going to vote on that yet. I've been very vocal that I would like to find a compromise solution. I think that there's this one end and the other end, and I think that there's something in between. There's a Project 515 that the Loghammer and Publix have been working on for a long time. It addresses the laws that are maybe discriminatory. I have articles on that too. I can send you a post if you want to email me. The bills have not, they're getting their first hearing this week.
Tuesday.
And I don't even know how they're, if they're even going to move out of committee. This is not my issue. I didn't run on this issue. I am not going to take a lead on this issue. I will eventually, actually I won't say I will eventually. I'm not sure I'll ever have to take a vote on this. I don't know if it's going to go to the floor. Just like some of these gun bills on the other side that were so divisive, those two may not ever come to the House floor for a final vote. So I'm just going to leave it at that. I do have the specific question on my survey, and I would encourage everyone to fill it out online and give me your opinion, because I am collecting that data and I do value it.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Yes.
Yeah, it's actually for
Senator Kent. Okay.
Yeah, it's Greg Woodbury. Talking about debates on the floor of the legislature, we did have some Senate debate with regard to setting up Minnesota healthcare exchanges in the last week. At least, I don't have the greatest of knowledge, just kind of some buzz conversation with friends, but there's a commission that's set up to establish the budget of that healthcare exchange. It's a 7-member commission, if I'm correct. That commission then makes a recommendation on the budget for the healthcare exchanges once they're established moving forward. And that budget then is forwarded on to the commissioner, I believe, of health.
NFC.
Yeah, okay, so that budget has no legislative accountability for the members of the commission. And the wording of the law as it stands right now, at least what was debated this last week, is that the commissioner shall pass that budget. So are you in favor of accountability for a budgetary setting commission if healthcare exchanges are established in Minnesota? And do they have to forward a budget that a commissioner shall pass on affecting state tax dollars?
We've just gone through, and believe me, it was a 12-hour day. It was sort of record-setting, I think, in the Senate. And I just want to
for what it's worth, I am the sole senator in the Minnesota Senate that did not ever hear that bill in a committee. So for me, I was very diligent about trying to follow it through the process as best I could, and then I was on that floor almost the entire time trying to hear the whole debate. So the issues you raise are legitimate, and I share some of those questions. Both houses passed different versions. We're going to go through conference committee. I know there is a lot of sensitivity to that issue of accountability on the budget, and I share it. And so, you know, I will be representing some of those viewpoints as we go through the rest of this process and get something final. But we have this deadline of the end of this month, and if we don't have a Minnesota version of this, we will have the federal version of this. And what we've got right now, warts and all, is more efficient and should hopefully represent some cost savings for Minnesota than if we go with the federal version. So, you know, this is one of those cases where I think we all need to keep trying to work together and make it as good as possible and know that it is a work in progress. You know, Minnesota has a tremendous tradition of doing things more cost efficiently than the rest of the country. That's why it's important to have a Minnesota version, and we need to keep that going forward.
Well, as a follow-up question, I guess a more specific question would be, yes, we have deadlines and requirements by the end of the month for passing healthcare exchanges or setting them up, and I agree, a state option is better than the federal take-it-or-leave-it kind of option. My question more, I think, goes along the lines of, are you personally in favor of legislative accountability, actually sticking in wording of the law that members of a budget-setting commission must abide by some level of accountability? Because as it stands right now, there is no accountability. So this is a nameless budget that has millions upon millions of dollars within it that no member is accountable for passing. So we could have tiddlywinks in there, but we don't know because there's no accountability. So are you personally in favor of legislative means for accountability for budget setting commissioners?
Yes, I'm going to continue to try to advocate for greater accountability as we go through this final stage of this process.
In a legislative manner? So that there's actually...
Right now, we're down to the conference committee, yes, some sort of legislative accountability, and I'm going to continue to advocate for that for the final product.
I hope you vote that.
Is that a follow-up question?
I'm not going to have it's unlikely I will be on the conference committee, so I will not have a final vote is the issue. But I will continue to represent what I believe to be the interests of my district, and I think some amount of legislative accountability is part of that.
Well, there goes that.
There go the lights again. Is there a question in the back?
Was that a follow-up question? Yes. Different topics?
Well, do we? You're monitoring, so.
Sure.
Was there any? Yes.
Okay, sure. Go ahead.
Okay, my name is Susan Larson, and I'm from Oak Park Heights. And Senator Kent, I just want to thank you. In a February 26 article in the Woodbury Bulletin, and I just want to get this right, you said you chose Spanish immersion for your son because it would open his eyes to the world and prepare him to live and work in a global environment in the future. So I want to thank you because you eloquently articulated something that many of us as parents value in education. This is the same mission and the same value that Crossman's Arts and Science School is trying to achieve. And it's the reason so many parents are working so hard to keep it open. What I think is happening, unfortunately, in the public is the interest of Spanish immersion and the survival of Crossman's are pitted against each other. Two questions is how can we work together to make sure both of these like-minded schools do well? And then will you talk to Senator Torres Gray and ask her to please have a hearing so we can have an honest
close the door.
Discussion about all the issues and questions?
Hey, close the door.
Close the door.
Let me try to address this because I'm standing here today as a senator for District 53,
right.
And as a member of the education committees in the Senate. And so what you're alluding to are very local issues, parts of them. There are parts of them that are state, and I'm going to come back to that. But some of what you're talking about is very local.
Yes.
And I think, first of all, I think it's not a fair characterization to say that it's pitting one against the other. Hang on, let me please finish. But that is a local question, and I'm, you know, that is going to need to be handled within the local jurisdictions and school boards as depending on how things play out. Now, at the state level, going back to explain this on the bigger level, there is a proposal in front of a bill in front of the House and the Senate. It'll be heard in the House on Tuesday. That the Purpich Center of the Arts would create a new district, a whole new school district, to run Crosswinds, and that would expand the Purpich mission, and it would do, and so that's the question that's being addressed in this bill. It is a complex question. You know, when you're in the Capitol and listening to the discussion, I can't tell you how many people have come up to me and said, "Aren't you excited? You're going to have a Purpich art school in Woodbury." People do not understand the issues. They don't know what Crosswinds is. They don't know about the 350 Crosswind students and their program and their needs. There is a lot of misinformation and confusion about this. I'm looking at this from the perspective as someone who has an obligation to students across the state. And it has to do with finance equity. It has to do with the question of integration, because this is being proposed as a big integration program, and right now our integration plan is scheduled to sunset as of, you know, and plans are being discussed of what we're going to do after all that sunsets, but it's really hard to look at this in isolation without the other. And then there's a very valid question about, is this the right thing for Purpich? Because right now Purpich, you know, has a school that's 11th and 12th graders focusing on arts, and now they're talking about adding 6th through 10th grade with the Crosswinds program. So there are a number of complex questions, and what I've been talking to fellow senators and people in our district and others about is, how do we properly look at these questions? Because, you know, the funding of all of this has ripple effects, not just in our, not just for Purpich and not just for the Crosswinds families, but for a bunch of school districts around and across the state. So you get into some equity questions. So thank you.
I appreciate that. Thank you. And I hope we can have a hearing.
Is there a follow-up to this particular question?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm Blaine Hooper from Woodbury. Sorry. I'll stand up too. On that, my understanding was that there was that there was no money tied to the bill. That there were no state funds, that it was a cost-neutral program to allow Purpich to have the building. Am I incorrect in that?
It depends on how you look at it, okay? Well, seriously, no. To Purpich, ostensibly, with the assumptions that they're making, it becomes revenue-neutral. Creating this new school district, and by having this, and they're, I think the number is 495 students that are part of this, they're assuming that we'll grow, the Crosswinds will grow to 495 students, and they're assuming where those students will be coming from. Each of those students, and this is true of anything, if a Stillwater student open enrolls into South Washington County, the money that it goes with that kid comes to South Washington County and vice versa. So this would be the same sort of an arrangement. If all these 495 students are at Crosswinds, the money would come with them from their home districts into this new district. And so it is revenue neutral for Purpich, and it's in theory revenue neutral for Crosswinds, but it's going to take $1.5 million out of St. Paul. It's going to take almost $400,000 out of South Washington County and North St. Paul, Oakwood, Maplewood, and it's going to take almost $200,000 out of Stillwater.
But it's revenue neutral for the state.
Well, no, hang on. Let me finish what I'm saying. So that's one part of it. So the question about revenue neutrality is relative. Okay. So that's that part. There are also questions. People are really questioning this idea, this proposal to create a new school district for 500 students that won't have the same sort of taxing authority that a traditional school district has. So it's revenue neutral for operating the school, but what's going to happen when we need a new roof or new HVAC or any of that? And this is my point. There may be perfectly good answers to those questions, but right now, that's not built into this proposal, and so these are some big questions that need to be answered.
And as the original question was, wouldn't a good place to work those out be at a hearing? Yeah. And therefore, shouldn't it be heard?
Heard in the House on Tuesday.
Right, but in the Senate.
Depending on what happens in the House and how it goes, it may be heard in the Senate.
Okay, will you support talking with Senator Torres?
We are having conversations all the time about it.
And will you support having a hearing?
It depends on how this all goes.
Okay. Follow-up question on
if we can have an open, sure. So the problem is, Purpich has a lobbyist running around putting out this idea that there's going to be a Purpich school for the arts in the East Metro, and nobody is available to talk about all the questions that are raised here. So we need to make sure that we can have a hearing that addresses all the complexity of this. We're going to need to,
we got to broader issue on the topic.
Okay.
So we'll
have to wrap up.
20 years ago, I lived in southern Minnesota. At the same time, the state shut down the university at Waseca. Okay, at that point, there was a lot of conversation about what should happen with this state building. And ultimately, it was sold to the federal prisons, took over the space. My understanding is if the Purpich bill doesn't pass, that the school would come to District 833, which sets a precedence of a state asset going to a local form of government. Okay. And I'm just wondering how you feel about the broader issue of state assets being made available to a local form of government with, broader than just our local constituency here.
The precedent is already being set because Harm Bay is doing the exact same thing in Roseville.
Yeah, I would say it's...
Well, no, that's also coming before you. So, I mean...
But I'm just saying, it's a bigger, complex question. I think, and the Attorney General is being asked about this as well, I think there's a very real question if these are emids to give away. You know, so these are separate questions, but the question of the bill ahead of us is, you know, is it the right thing for everybody involved for this perfect proposal to go through?
I don't know. We've got about 10 minutes left. I want to be respectful of time, and I will wait after, and if we wanted to have a little separate crosswinds meeting, that's fine. I'd like to touch on one topic that we didn't get to. I think there's a lot of business owners in here, and I think they showed up for a discussion on cost of doing business in Minnesota, potential tax increases on pass-through income. Now that we've got the biz-to-biz service tax done, that's pretty good. But we're talking about minimum wage increases, and that really affects a lot of restaurant owners. Is there anyone in the room that wanted to speak to that issue that hasn't spoken yet? Okay, go ahead.
Joe Ryan, Woodbury. One of the things, and because you sit on the Work Comp Advisory Council, and this is kind of a two-part tie here, we're increasing minimum wage. Also, January 2014, when Obamacare fully kicks in, for better or for worse, okay, in our state, we have the highest premiums in work comp for businesses, okay? Our work comp division at Dolly is self-funded through assessments and penalties against businesses, so they have an inherent conflict of interest. They get paid if they rule against businesses. In the 15 years I've lived in Minnesota, I've yet to see a major business move in here. That's part of the reason why. My question is, when is work comp going to be equitable? Because come January, these doctors are going to figure out real fast, and some of them already have. They'll get paid three times as much if they say, yep, this back is obviously related to work and years of work versus, no, that's a degenerative condition. Okay? So they're going to get paid three times as much. They're going to be motivated to say it's work-related because we have increased modifiers to pay above the Medicare rate here in Minnesota, which is unfair to business.
How am I going to solve that? I'm just going to call the governor and tell him. He's going to go, Peter, you're right. That is a concern, and when we talk about increasing wages for every dollar that an employer pays more to the employee, that's also augmented with additional costs behind the scenes that employers pay with work comp and unemployment insurance and stuff. It's very much a hot topic in the work comp board, especially this back issue. So I just want to say we're working on it. The council is balanced, which is what I like about the council. It does have equal voice between business and labor, so that helps. Things that come out of the work comp council sometimes are major changes that everyone's happy with. Sometimes they're just technical. This year it's a lot of technical little things that they're fixing up. These issues are so divisive that that's why they created the council. There were apparently long floor debates on work comp issues in the legislature, and they're like, we have to get this off the floor and work these differences out in these councils. They're open to the public. I saw a couple people in the back. Now I don't know if they left. Oh, there you are, Lynn and Greg. They come to a lot of the meetings. They're involved in some of the issues. So, you know, I encourage people, if you're interested in that, to come to the meetings, get involved, have a meeting with me. And like I said, I do have a pretty good relationship with the Department of Labor as well, and I can get messages through and say, hey, what about this idea? What about this idea? And then I'm sure when the governor sees it, he'll go, I'm right on, and he'll say, that's right.
There's a question here.
Yes.
Right over there.
Hi, Jim.
Are you ready?
Yes.
No. I'm old man Hasselman. I'll tell you why, and that's literally. I'm 70 years old. And in those 70 years, the word common sense always came to my mind. Always came to my mind. So I'm thinking about the government. Realize I'm in the ninth inning of my life. I'm in the fourth quarter. I'm not going to be around. My kids are. My grandchildren are. We got to start thinking of them here in America. So here's a common sense, one of them I say. I ran a business with 72 people. The little success I had was because of my people. Only my people. That's the success I have. Now, you want what you want, some of the people in this room, or I should say some of our officials, is we got a government that's running the biggest government in the world, and 50% of them hate the other 50%. How do you run a business hating each other, doing things like this? You have to get together and be real Americans. This disturbs me. How can a president get up there and say to the people, listen, you people are taking the food away from our poor people, our handicapped people, and on that very same day, he gave $250 million to the Brotherhood, the Muslim Brotherhood, and before that, he gave $1.5 billion so they could have arms, and they could have this to come after us, to come after Israel. Let's start thinking of our children, for God's sakes. Start thinking of them. And do what you think is right.
Thank you.
Thank you. I want you to live longer than this meeting. were there any other comments about the cost of doing business issues that are related to the governor's budget and such?
So well, yeah.
You got us here listening. So.
It's a little hard to follow that, I guess, but this was about the minimum wage. My name is Matt Anderson. I'm from Woodbury. My company is also located here in Woodbury. Myself along with my brother, we own 10 bowling centers in the metro area. Actually 9 in the metro and 1 down in Rochester. And altogether we have just under 400 employees, and around 50% of those are tipped employees. So obviously the minimum wage is, you know, a big concern to us because those tipped employees make minimum wage, and you know, we're talking about a 30% increase in the minimum wage. And I just wanted to see what you thought about a tip credit, like what I believe 43 other states have. Basically every other state around us has that, you know, which would allow us to pay our tipped employees less money than the minimum, simply because they are, frankly, they're some of our highest paid employees in our entire establishment. We have a lot of trouble actually promoting them to management positions with salaries and benefits. And
I got an email from you, right?
You did?
Yeah. I thought I recognized that story.
And just to put this in context, right now the Minnesota state minimum wage is lower than the federal minimum wage, so when we talk about a percentage increase, Minnesota employees are being paid at the federal minimum wage level. So even if we increase the state minimum wage to the federal level, it's an increase, but nobody's going to spend more money. So I just, a little math background there. If the federal wage matches the federal wage, you're currently paying your employees at the federal level, right?
Correct.
Right. So you will not, just because if the state just raises the minimum wage at the state level to the federal level, it's a wash for you. Is the point I'm trying to make?
Yeah, but isn't the state considering going to?
I'm just establishing that for math purposes, for background for everybody. I just wanted to make sure that's clear, because when we talk about this, there are different proposals and different bills, and some of them are, you know, to 9-something, some of them are to 10-something, and you know, some of those look like, it sounds like it's a 50% increase, which is a lot, but it's math because of the difference between state and federal. I just wanted to clarify that
based on what I understand, we're currently paying $7.25, but right, 2020 we'll be paying close to $11.
Is that federal?
That's one of the state proposals, exactly.
So I'm just establishing where we stand right now.
Okay.
And then I'm to talk about the proposals. You know, I think I am very, as like I said, I come from a business background, had a small business myself. I'm very sensitive to the stress that this puts on us economically, and I believe we need to be very careful. On the other hand, there's a lot of research that says that modest increases in minimum wage puts more pockets, money in everybody's pocketbook, and then that helps economic activity across the board. So to me, it's a question of sort of a balanced discussion on the overall minimum wage level. I do think that some of the levels that are in the current proposals are a little too aggressive.
Well,
the only other thing I would say, and then back to the tip writer, I'm coming to it.
Okay.
I do have some questions about that. I've been a waitress in my life a number of times, and I don't necessarily think that we can lower the wages on the current server staffs. But if we do an increase, I think there's a space in there where we could create, carve out a tip credit so that it's not a full increase, you know, that we're not matching the minimum wage increase for the servers as we are for other workers. Does that make sense?
It does, but I mean, do you agree that servers and bartenders should be some of the highest paid people in a restaurant environment?
I don't think it's fair. I don't think it's a fair characterization to say that they're some of the highest paid people in America.
Well, I do the pay.
Maybe in your organization, and that's a different question.
If I could just make a kind of follow-up point, most people in this room, I'm sure, I'm Paul Svensson. I live in Wayzata, but I have a business here in Woodbury and other businesses. I think most people don't understand tip credit, but tip credit, as it relates to minimum wage, affects every single person in this room if they dine out in a restaurant or full-service restaurant. What tip credit is a state, if minimum wage is, say, $7 in round numbers, and you're allowed to take $2 tip credit, that means you can pay $5 an hour to your employees as long as they make at least the other $2 up to minimum wage in tips. But what people don't understand, the two independent restaurants that I represent, we have almost 75,000 hours of tip wages every year. So minimum wage went up $2.10 from 207 to 209. It's Senate File 504, I believe it is, has it go up to $10.55, another $3.30 increase. And without tip credit, from 207 to 215, our businesses will have to increase our prices to our customer $1,750,000, all passed on to you. The opponents of tip credit say that the servers, the tipped employees are very hardworking, which they are, but they are the highest paid servers or employees in our business. The people that work in the kitchen, they also work very hard, wash dishes, prep, cook, and cook. They have a tendency to make more around $10, $11, $12 an hour, whereas servers in a full-service restaurant, maybe not some of your small cafes, will make often two and three times that amount with tips. They'll make $17, $20, or $25 an hour, bartenders and so forth. So when you pass a minimum wage increase without a tip credit, who you really hurt are the lowest paid people in our industry, the cooks and the dishwashers and so forth, because we have to raise our prices to accommodate this $1.75 million to you, our customers. We're hesitant to raise our prices any more than we have to, because as a full service restaurant, every time we do, we increase the gap between you maybe deciding to eat at home a little more often, or going to a counter service restaurant. There's getting to be some real nice ones, some niches, panera bread, for example. No tipping allowed. They employ way fewer people, and they'll pay, their servers will not get $25 or $20 or $17 an hour typically. So you're hurting actually the people that you think you're helping when you don't have tip credit, because there become fewer hours, fewer jobs and fewer hours in the full service restaurant business. So I would like to, those are some reasons to support tip credit. I would like to ask you, of legislators that have maybe been lobbied by people that oppose tip credit, what reasons are they giving you that would make you support not having tip credit in the state of Minnesota?
First of all, I have not been lobbied by anyone.
I haven't either.
With those ideas, with that whole, on that issue at all.
Me neither. And I would just say, and that's exactly what I was saying to Matt. I have questions about if and how much the minimum wage should be raised in the first place, and if it is raised, I do think there is room in there to carve out potentially some amount of a tip credit. I just want to be careful that, you know, we don't
effectively have a wage cut.
And we don't want unintended consequences.
Right.
We're going to be watching out for
right.
that.
But I'm very open and receptive to the concerns that you've just expressed, because I think you've just articulated it all very, very well.
Rep Ward and I both work on the minimum wage,
living wage
job committee. This was brought up in committee. I see someone that was in the committee, and we heard the author of the bill, Rep Winkler, say, yes, I am open to discussing tip credit. So it's on record. It was said in committee. I would say you restaurant owners hold Rep Winkler accountable to that. And I do support it. I do support tip credit.
And do come and talk to us.
Yeah. Yeah. It's wrapping up. It's after 12. I'm happy to hang around, but I might need to take a bathroom break. Senator Kent needs to leave. So, but I'll hang around here for a couple more minutes.
And
thank
I just
you
want to
thank
much.
Everybody
thank
again
you.
For coming.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.